What up, y'all? It's Maj and Taj, and you know we're back on the Fire and Ash channel. We're gonna do our first music react to J. Cole's new album, The Off Season. Everybody loves J. Cole. Glad he finally dropped something. We got two other hip hop heads with me. I will let them introduce themselves.
Yo, yo, yo! What's good? What's good, man? It's your boy Main, also known as Main Forever. I'm on YouTube as Main Forever, Twitch.tv/Main Forever as well. Avid J. Cole fan, so your boy Taj, I already knew what he was doing when he asked me to get on this. So, yeah, I mean, I'm just, you know, yeah, we here.
It's your boy Jay, a.k.a. Smooth Criminal, a.k.a. Smooth, you know what it is. Hey, I'm new to this thing, and I'm here with my boy, and we here to listen to some good music. Let's get it.
Sound good to me.
So, obviously, everyone knows J. Cole. That man himself doesn't need an introduction. He's finally got another album. I don't even know how long. I mean, I got Spotify, but I can probably look. But what was his last album before this one?
His last album before this one was KOD. I think it came out in 2017 or 2018. Can't remember. But yeah, it was KOD.
Yeah, his studio album. Then he had Revenge of the Dreamers and stuff with everybody on it. But KOD. So, you know, a good few years, 3 years or whatever. Quick math. Yeah. So, yeah, you know, we'll just get into it. We're going to go through it track by track, give our thoughts, and we'll see what's good.
All right, let's get it.
All right. 95 South.
95 South.
First one.
I'm mad he didn't do South like S-O-U-F.
F.
That's y'all era right there.
Yeah.
Y'all in college and shit. Hey, y'all know Cole a little bit older than y'all.
Nah, man, he older than me. Well, nah, he 37, right?
Yeah,
I'm 37.
Oh, y'all say oh, so that's why this shit resonates.
Yeah, you already know.
Oh shit, there's a lot to unpack right there.
That was a good ass opening. Obviously it's hard on a first listen
to catch really everything.
All the bars and the nuances, but I think that was a good ass opening track, to be honest.
Yeah, the shot value with Cam, I think that shit just like, that's like the perfect way to set it off. And like, when if you listen to the last couple of Cole like albums and songs, you get kind of a more of a mellow vibe from him. Mm-hmm. So to hear him come, to hear him come in with that kind of energy,
off the rip,
that was like the perfect way to start it off. Because me, a Cole fan, I'm just expecting more of the same. So when he start off with that shit, bro, I mean there was some bars in there, but you gonna have to go unpack that shit,
of course.
Bro. When he said Krispy Kreme dreams, my niggas want to kill 12. Oh my god, hey,
the fucking put the M on your head, you Luigi's brother now. Yeah. Come on, come on, man.
He said if the beef do come around, put an M all on your head, you Luigi brother now. Oh, hey,
man, killing it. I do like you said though, the ending with the whole. Man, like it's like Lil Jon and the East Side Boys.
That's exactly what that was.
Yeah, I mean, was it like a direct sample? It sounded like it was
a direct sample,
bro. And I'm like, man, represent, boy. We used to be in high school tripping off that shit. Football games and basketball games, looking at the other team. That's a hype ass track. You're right.
He knew that would resonate. And then, like, the connection with the shit being called 95 South. Like, if you from the Carolinas or you got family in up north, you know that's a direct route. That's what we do. Like, if we going up north to see family, like, you taking 95 South to come down to South Carolina, coming from New York or whatever. So, that shit was that. Oh, this is a whole bunch of shit that was just dope in there.
Yeah. All right. Well, it's a good, very good opening track. We'll get into the next one. Amari.
Yes, sir.
Loving the vibe on that joint.
Yeah, I think that one was produced very well. I mean, I'm sure it all is. Obviously, it's fucking J. Cole, but
yeah, that's the crazy part.
It was mixed well. But you know, like you said, after the first track, his energy, and we usually are used to a more laid back Cole, and even that one wasn't like super aggressive. It was still pretty aggressive for what you would expect. Usually, J. Cole is like just sitting back, spitting knowledge, and
exactly.
Seems like he's kind
of... It's a good mix. I see a lot of people try to get into that more. I think what it is they understand that it's an art to be able to like speak the way they do and make it current for people who like... I think that's what he was trying to do. He was trying to like one thing I give Jay-Z kudos on is like he's good at adapting with the times. Mm-hmm. Even though, you know, he get more props than anything. But like J. Cole is actually adapting like his sound to be a little bit more modern, but not... He's not compromising. Right. You know what I'm saying? He's still giving you the knowledge and stuff like that. So that's why I love him, bro.
I feel you, because that definitely sounded... Amari kind of sounded like a track today. More heavily auto-tuned and a little bit of singing. And not as like just, you know, heavy on the lyrics. More just vibey, like you said, as soon as the song went off. Mm-hmm. It was a vibe. And
want to check to see who produced that.
Yeah, that's the crazy thing too. It's like he was open, a lot more open this time to like features and like, you know what I'm saying, like just getting more producers in. I remember him talking about that on the documentary and stuff like that, just talking about wanting to work with more people. So it's interesting to hear the sounds now after hearing that, because he's like, dang, well, he usually produces on shit and he got in-house producers too. So what's different this time? And I don't know. I think if he finally worked with Timbaland like he said he did, then this was probably one. This sound like a more Timbaland joint to me. I don't know. Yeah, you know how Timbaland like to do his signature shit, but it's I could hear some of this, some of that stuff that he do.
Yeah,
I could hear some of his sounds, and I was like, that sound like Timbaland right there.
Mm-hmm. You know your shit, man.
You know, I listened to a lot of Genuine when I was younger. That's why.
All right, we're going to get into the next one. My Life with 21 Savage and Morey. I know who Morey is. With 21 Savage.
Oh, Morey is his artist.
Oh, is one of his people on Dreamville? Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. I still have dug deep into a lot of them.
I kind of like that dude, too.
Yeah, me too.
Quicksand something, is it?
Quicksand. Yeah. That shit go hard.
Okay, y'all to put me on. I'll be behind. I'm old. Forgive me. all right, My Life. Let's check it out.
My world, my life.
All right, that was My Life.
Yes, sir. Another vibe. The vibes keep coming.
Yeah, obviously J. Cole did his thing. I'm not the hugest 21 Savage fan, but I feel like he went well on that track. I feel like
definitely.
I mean, he wasn't slacking. Normally, like I can't do no damn 21,
right?
But you know, for what he was, for what he's able to put out, it fit the album.
Yeah, it fit the song.
I can definitely tell you that's probably his, if not his best verse ever. Like
guest like, verse.
He been on a different vibe ever since him and Cole linked up. Like on that first, like on that track. Well, I can't remember the name of the song, but he was flowing on that shit, bro. I'm going to keep that shit a buck. Like, somebody who was highly critical of all those rappers in that lane when they first dropped, his maturation process is out of this world, bro. And you could tell it's because of who he's surrounding himself with.
Right.
And I think Morey came on there and did his thing. If you heard some of his older music, you're like, yeah, this is his lane. And he killed that shit.
Now, I was going to say, because he was doing the singing and the hook. And yeah, he was killing it. Layering with himself and everything. That was probably
When he raps, he definitely adds harmonics and all the tones and all that shit.
Okay.
I definitely like that dude.
I'm about to check him out.
That shit was fire.
All right, cool. Another good song. We're going to keep it moving. Number 4, Applying Pressure. Yeah. Oh, not the air horns. What year is this? Okay.
I love that he was talking his shit, but yeah. I wish he would have did another verse, no bullshit.
I mean, I agree, because I really did like that beat.
And that one sounds like a J. Cole beat. That sounds like a J. Cole beat.
I don't feel like he used that beat to its potential, sadly. Me but I do like...
Go ahead. He was definitely sending a message to somebody. Like, it felt like... It's like... He was clearly, man, do it and gotta do it. I'm gonna fuck you, nigga.
Bitch. Yeah, I gotta do it. But yeah, that definitely sounded like a J. Cole beat. And that shit gave me Born Sinner vibes. And like, I could tell, I think he produced this one. And I think I'm gonna say Jake One produced My Life. I'm gonna say that's a Jake One beat right there. But yeah. I'm calling these producers out. I'm going to see how many I get right.
That's produced by J. Cole. No other producers are credited on Applying Pressure.
Hey, I told you. I'm telling you, I know this guy, bro.
You do.
I'm telling you, bro.
You are the J. Cole stan of the century.
I'm telling you, that shit sound like a J. Cole beat.
And see, funny enough, because, you know, I'm the Lupe stan, and when he was doing that whole outro, he was, like, talking about niggas not realizing and shit. Lupe did that on a specific track.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole time I was just, you know, thinking Lupe, but that's just because I'm always thinking Lupe, because that's my guy. I appreciate it. I appreciate that. But I do agree with you. I wish he would have used that beat a little more.
Me
that
too. I wish he would have kept rhyming. That beat was smooth. And he was killing it.
Mm-hmm. Came in hard too. Started my grind with crime festers, and now was showing like they in their second trimesters.
Showing nine like they second trimester. God.
And he still had the same, you know, energy. It's more like raw and like, I don't want to say like bravado rap, but still, it's not the laid back Cole. Still, I think on My Life, he was probably a little more laid back out of the four tracks we've heard. But so this he's definitely a little more aggressive in the off season.
Yep.
Interesting. Punching the Clock, number 5. Let's check it out.
Get it. Let's get it.
All them niggas that sold cane, they started singing like Danity. Now I'm left here paid like a plan. Damn.
Oh shit, hold on, what?
Those situations are handled way before the time comes.
What?
I think when you truly
all them niggas that sold cane, they started
singing
like
Danity. Oh my god.
You fail in those moments.
This man, you crash. You something else.
Damn.
Whether people see it or whether people know it or not.
Hey.
All right. So
hey, he's just on a different wave this time. Like I don't know. Somebody was talking shit to him before he made this shit. Like, cause it's just a whole nother aura, bro. It's like a whole nother approach. Like, I ain't seen this shit since like the warm up days type shit.
It's like he's hungry again.
Yeah. Honestly, this the energy that he's coming with. Like I said, we were talking about the energy from the first track, but it's real, man. And one thing and I noticed.
One thing you know what you notice.
Well, he had, I don't want to say he had one rhyme scheme, but he, this whole track, although it's a short track, you know, looking on Spotify, it's one of the shorter ones. It might be the shortest, just under 2 minutes. But like he's using the Anity rhyme throughout all of it. Like he opens. Clutching Sanity. Then he has like some, you know, some B rhymes and some C rhyme schemes. But throughout the whole time, that's the main rhyme scheme. All the way to the end, all them niggas is so cane. They started singing like Danity. And that's not fucking easy to do.
No, I was just about to say that's impressive itself.
Hell yeah. I was kind of, because halfway through, I was like, is he still going with the Anity shit? So I was kind of listening for it. And I just pulled up the lyrics.
He said something about he got more cribs than Habitat and Humanity. I didn't understand that. But my cousin, he was like, hold up. What the fuck Cole know about it? I was like, why you say that? Because I was in there shopping for my baby, and they sure got a lot of fucking cribs in there. So I was just like, it's like, damn, I'm just trying to figure out what the hell Jake doing in there. Yeah. So I'm like, damn. I'm like, whew. He just coming a whole different way this time.
That man is a monster, bro.
I'm telling you, bro.
All right, who produced this one?
Let me look at the list. There's a lot of people up here that I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm gonna guess that this was. I don't think it was T minus. I'm gonna say it was this. Tommy Parker, dude?
Nah, this one's produced by Tay Beast and Mario Luciano.
I was gonna say Tay Beast because I was like, that sounds like some shit. I don't know any of those guys.
Tay Beast.
Yeah. I don't know a lot of these people. I don't know.
Oh, that's funny. That was nice though. That was a good one. And
that beat was fire.
It's not even so much to say because it's Cole. Like, you know, I like to break down rhyme schemes and patterns and shit, but Cole always comes with it and it comes correct. So,
yep, he cares about the craft.
Yeah, yeah, and that's what we love to see.
That's what makes it so dope.
All right,
the bars is just a plus,
a big plus, because he's fucking killing them every song so far. I'm like, oh, that was a good line, at least like twice. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
100 mil with Bass, and I'm a big Bass fan. I don't know if I've heard anything bad from
it's
that
Boz. You're not gonna do my boy like that. It's Boz.
My bad, Boz. I'm gonna keep saying Bass, okay? Because
that's disrespectful. I'm gonna call you Tash from now on.
Do it. Hey,
Nash and Tash. Nash and Tash.
You know what I mean? So I'm gonna stream Mage and Tash.
Mage and Tash. Oh,
shit. It'd be like that, man. It'd be like that. We got 100 mil with Abaz. Who's the homie? Let's check it out.
Shout out to Abaz. He also stream on Twitch.
Does he?
FIFA 2K, yeah.
Man, I'm about to
and he do a lot right of studio now. Sessions. He do a lot of studio sessions, bro. It's so dope to see him in there.
He only got 8K followers? I'm in there. Make sure y'all go give Boz a follow on Twitch, twitch.tv/Boz. All right, that was 100 mil with Boz.
Boz on the vocals, yeah, Bossy Boz.
Yeah.
The Fiend Boz. Yeah, that shit was just, it's just, that's just a reoccurring theme. Like, every song is a fucking vibe. Like, it's good for people who, like, this, if this might sound crazy, but this is a good first J. Cole album if you're not really a huge J. Cole fan, because there's something for everybody in here. Like, if you just like, oh, I'm gonna listen to Cole because everybody say he's so fire, and the first thing you hear is 95 South, you're gonna keep going,
right?
So like, yeah. And then if you're like, I can't really get with Cole, man, he always rapping about this and that, and then you hear like, you know, what was it? Applying Pressure or maybe My Life. You'd be like, damn, that's kind of, this a little bit different right here. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I feel like this got something for everybody so far. So everything's about
100 mil was nice. I did like Boss on the vocals. One thing that stood out to me was he had that whole the Michael B. Jordan line. If Michael B. Jordan call and his girl and go, does he not know that he's on the same damn level as Michael B. Jordan? Like, he said that like he was a regular ass nigga.
Michael B. Jordan, the sexiest man alive on the magazine.
Bro, I'm telling you, he real recognized, bro. He knows.
Yeah, he know what it is.
He said my girl ain't
picking up.
Yeah,
my girl ain't picking up.
He said, Stanley, I can't say the same for you, nigga.
Hey, my girl better pick up if Michael B. Jordan call. Goddamn. Hey.
I'm like, baby.
I'm gonna keep it real. You know what I'm saying?
Go get a bag, baby. It's all good.
Do what you gotta do. Come home in a week or next year, whatever. Just come home, please.
I wouldn't even blame. You think I'm gonna be mad at her?
Right.
I'm not gonna be mad.
That's what I'm like, J. Cole, you and Michael, you know what I'm saying? Y'all, that was funny to me. But it was good.
That I ain't sharing.
Oh, you ain't
Michael B. Jordan catch these, I'll punch him in the kneecaps.
Oh, that's funny. All right, we are already halfway through. Damn, shit flying. All right, six songs left. We're on 7. Pride is the Devil with Lil Baby. How y'all feel about Lil Baby?
I wish you watched this. I wish you like saw this because they didn't have the feature showing until today. I wish you would have. Oh man, that would have been the greatest. They still gonna be dope. Just play this joint.
All right, we'll see.
I like him.
You like the baby?
Yeah,
I like Lil Baby.
Yeah. Hey, just
Lil Baby and the baby. I always begin to like Lil Baby. Yeah.
Listen, this just listen, bro.
Pride is the devil. Pride is the devil.
Hey, he did his thing on that shit, boy.
Hold on me.
Pride is the devil. Pride is the devil. Number 7.
Got all on me. Pride is the devil.
This track and the last track was both produced by T-Minus.
Yeah, T-Minus.
Oh yeah, that's T. That definitely sounds like a T-Minus joint. He did plenty of tracks with T-Minus. And I could tell that was T-Minus off the rip for sure.
I like that whole track, the vibe of it. Mm-hmm. What he was, the message. There was a message to it.
Cole was like, then the Cole's first verse. I was like, damn,
yeah, that's deep. Uh-huh. He said, make it feel different when people say they're proud of you. That's how crazy it is. It's like, damn, the way I feel about pride, like I don't even know how to feel about you saying you're proud of me. You know what I'm saying? It's like, that shit's crazy, man.
It makes you think, and that's what good music will make you think.
And you know what I love about this? So a lot of, like, lately, especially Drake, like, Drake made this real popular, like, continuously saying these catchy, lines over and over again in the song. Mm-hmm. Like, those usually be people's favorite songs because they like what you said and they get to hear it a lot.
Right.
So not only do you do that, but you put bars in there. Like, that shit, that's what I like. He's like, he bringing a different dynamic to what people are already doing. You know, so we get all the catchy shit. We get all the beats we like. You know, they get all the modern stuff that they want to hear. And they also get bars, lessons. Like, you know, just like it's different when you bring. That's what makes a true artist right there. Like being able to take your lane and infuse it into somebody else's and not be forced.
Right. And not like, lose your own identity.
Yeah. Not compromising. Right. Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And you know, I asked about Lil Baby. We got to give it to him. He sounded natural on the track. You know, he definitely sounded like he belonged. And
yeah,
you sound like you don't really like Lil Baby sometimes.
I mean, I it's not my type. I'm old. I'm an old head. I'm gonna keep it real. I don't really listen to a lot of these new kids or whatever. But I can always appreciate it. And one thing that happens a lot, I think, in today's music anyway, is they'll try and get features with whoever, and they don't go well on the track or the type of song. And even
this
if
wasn't
you,
that.
Yeah, right. None of them, even, you know, 21 Savage on his, like he fit, you know what I'm saying?
When I first seen 21 was on there, I was like, but then I was like, oh, okay.
They got chemistry though. They got chemistry. Yeah, they really rock with each other. They really rock with each other. Like they got documentaries of them in the studio together and stuff. They really rock with each other.
Right.
And that's another thing I love about Cole, man. It's like he's from the era of the old heads. Like that's what he come up on. Mm-hmm. But he's not a gatekeeper like they were. You know,
like me.
Some of them. Yeah, I mean, it's like. And I was the same way. Like if it was trap, I didn't want to hear it. If it was this, I didn't want to hear it. But like people like Lil Baby, like changing that narrative a little bit because he can actually flow, bro. Like he might not have the deepest, dopest bars or whatever, but as long as you can flow, I don't care. Because for so long it's this slurred, you know, just say whatever type shit. And it, you know what I'm saying? But you can tell Lil Baby is looking at what he's saying.
Right.
He's writing.
Yeah. Yeah. You can tell it. Yeah.
I don't know.
It's fire. I'm loving it.
Yeah, it's good. I like it. But I do, like I said, I want to give a shout out to the producers. Not that they'll probably ever see this, but, you know, I'm pretty sure it's their job to, you know, make sure the artist that you get fits on the track. And so far, they've done a good job. Because I'm tired of hearing people that don't belong.
Yeah. Shit. This shit was constructed well, man. Yeah,
for sure. All right, let's go. Let Go My Hand with Boz and Black 6 Lakh. Let us on when he called people out for that. Number 8, let's check it out.
That was a vulnerable track right there.
Yeah.
Vulnerable track. No, not too many rappers admit to ever losing a fight, let alone being afraid to fight and afraid to die.
Mm-hmm.
And then his last scrap was with Puff Daddy, and then he has Puff Daddy on the outro. Like,
that's crazy.
That's cool as shit to me.
I can definitely hear that's DJ Dahi right there. And I hear some Cole in there too. So I wouldn't be surprised if that's DJ Dahi and Cole on that shit. Cause that I can definitely hear the Cole sounds, but that DJ Dahi, like that like cadence, that's DJ Dahi for sure. He makes some fire shit.
He's the first listed producer, and then Frank Dukes, then J. Cole, then Wu-Tang.
Oh, okay. That's where these dudes come from. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, then I think DJ Dahi probably produced the whole joint, and then J. Cole right. probably came behind it. Yeah,
with all touched some stuff up.
Yeah.
So I always like when, and I guess it's more of a new thing, I guess, and it doesn't happen a lot, but when artists will talk about their interactions with other artists on the track, mm-hmm. makes them feel more
authentic, personable. Real.
Yeah.
Someone like, you can relate to. Like, oh, you're a real human.
Yeah, exactly.
They're giving you the scoop. Like, oh, shit.
Okay. Yeah, a little bit of insight, and that's cool as fuck. But as I said, again, I don't know if I'm going to cut this in or not, but that whole first verse, or the main verse, almost was like the only verse, really, other than the singing. I think this was like the first time he was like really laid back on the track. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like you could tell, like, instead of like being up and shit, he was kind of like sitting back. Like a lot of older Cole stuff, but he had a very Andre 3000 feel and approach, and I loved it because I mean I fucking love Andre 3000 as most people do. But
it was story time Cole. I love story time Cole, bro. Because the beat always sound like it's like it's just atmosphere, and you're sitting talking to him. That's why I love story time Cole.
I think that's where he's at his best, personally.
Yeah, but that's his best pocket for sure.
That might be a little biased on me because I love hip hop that tells a story and has, you know, something with it. So, but nah, I really enjoyed that track. Hell yeah. Anything else on number 8?
Let's get it, man.
It's the one he put out, and this I fucking love this shit.
What?
Yeah.
This is the song he put out like before the whole album came out.
The interlude?
Yeah.
All right. Well, number 9, we're on to
Interlude. You ain't heard it yet?
Haven't heard this?
No. I didn't even. Okay, because I remember people like, yo, we're releasing this song early from the track. I didn't listen to it because I wanted to.
Okay.
This
song, so I wanted what about The Climb Back? Have you heard The Climb Back?
I haven't heard
it. He released that like a year or two ago. Okay. So I might
have heard The Climb Back. Maybe.
I'm very envious of your position right now, because if I would have heard these two songs back to back, I would have lost my shit. So let's go.
All right, let's check it out. Interlude. Let's go. Number 9.
For the first time?
For the first time.
Now I'm at your neck, nigga. Yeah.
Now I'm at your neck, nigga. Okay, he coming with it. No. So should we these two songs go together?
Not like that, but okay, it's just okay. It's just the fact these that, you're getting to hear them back to back.
Yeah.
For the first time. Yeah. Like, sheesh. It's just envy, pure envy, bro.
Now, yeah, he has some bars on that one.
Yeah, because my homeboy Cam, he's another J. Cole fan, and like he had never heard these two songs, and he was like, it's my first time hearing. I'm like, I wish I was you, bro. So fire. But yeah, that was just pure gas.
Y'all got anything to say on that one?
Did you catch the surrogate mother line, bro?
I did. That was early. He said something about carrying
the
babies.
EMTs have to carry your baby like surrogate mothers. Whoa. Yeah.
That, hey, man, I mean, I don't expect less from J. Cole, though. Like, it's almost hard to be impressed.
Yeah, it really is.
Like, if someone else came up with that line, I'd be like, oh, shit. You know what I'm saying?
Keep the rewind material, bro. Right. Keep the rewind material.
But, I mean, it's a good line regardless. He had a lot of good lines in that one. Obviously, it's hard. I haven't pulled up the lyrics. I think I did for one track just to make sure. The one where I said that he had the rhyme scheme the whole way.
You know a nigga fire when he tell you you gonna play his shit back. Like on the Friday Night Lights, he was like, when they hear this line, they gonna rewind and think, oh shit. Like who says that in their song? So you're rewinding and saying, oh shit, to the part where he said, you're gonna rewind and think, oh shit. Like, it's just, this dude is different, bro. Yes, it always has been. All
right, let's keep it going. We got 3 songs left. We're on number 10, The Climb Back. Let's check it out. This is the longest song on the album. And it already came out, apparently, so I'm hearing it for the first time. Which is more important, getting
or letting go? That's real.
I ain't never heard. That's no real. Rapper. I don't know. Maybe I don't know if I just missed it or not. I ain't never heard a fucking rapper use the word derivative in a way that he used it. and he even said it. I'm trying to find a derivative. You niggas don't feel me. Like, y'all don't know what he's talking about. I love that shit.
Look, it's all who took a college calculus class, all right? Fuck derivatives.
Yeah.
Bro, that shit he said at the end stuck with me, though. Like, because I had already heard the song a couple times, but, like, listening to it over and over again, I never really paid attention to, like, what he said at the end. But he was like, everybody mentioned suicide prevention. They even got a hotline. And then he was like, but what about, like, when
homicide
niggas are stressed out and, like, they feel like their only way to live is to clap back? Like, where's the hotline for that? Mm-hmm. That could save another life. That could save two lives, right. You know? So that, I mean, it's not discrediting the fact that there's a hotline, a suicide prevention hotline. It's just saying that's nice, like, but where is it for the people? Like, almost, you know, almost like, you know what I'm saying, just putting a light on systematic, you know, stuff. Like if we know that there is neighborhoods full of people who are doing this, why would we have any assistance for them to turn away from that? You know what I'm saying? It's like, so just shining the light on that. When he do stuff like that, that's just, you know, that's just another plus on who he is. So it's just,
yeah,
like, stuff like that is just fire. Besides all the dope ass, like, for show or blow your clothes half off like a promo code.
Yeah. Well, now I'm like, oh. Hey. This is just a good track overall. Very well produced. Again, who produced it?
This one sounded like it had T-minus in it, but I know that J. Cole snare and kick, so that's definitely J. Cole.
J. Cole's the only credited producer on this track.
I'm telling, I know that snare and that kick, bro.
I'm impressed.
Yeah, honestly, you. It's I'm easy, almost more bro. Impressed by that than the bars. I mean, shit. That takes an ear, bro. Like, you had to study.
There's nothing he made that I haven't heard, bro. Like, literally.
So for that track, man, I don't know. I think it resonated with me just playing sports and, you know, in the position that I was in. But the whole, like, mid part where he's talking about, like, his boy being envious and shit. And
yeah.
And I feel like a lot of people can relate to that at some point in their life, whether, you know, it's a job or sports or anything. Relationship. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And someone's just kind of, they looking at you, know, they want your spot. And I feel like he really mm-hmm. captured that, the emotions that go with that. Very well, and that was that really stuck out for me in that song.
Yep.
All right, two more, and that's it. We got Close next, number 11. Check it out.
Yeah.
Another vulnerable track.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Y'all know who he's talking about?
No, you know?
I don't.
He definitely talk. He's either painting a picture from another perspective, like he did on For Your Eyes Only, mm-hmm. or he's talking to somebody specifically, because I don't feel like any of that shit is something he was actually a part of, but he does like to, him and Kendrick, like to put themselves in somebody else's body and make them rap.
Right.
Like, they do that a lot, and it's so fire, so vivid. Because you know how people say, well, when I'm rapping, I'm telling my homie stories. Like, he's literally telling their stories. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I feel like that's what that is. I could be wrong.
That Lupe also does that. Okay. Just gotta throw my man in there.
That's why Lupe is one of the best. That's why he's one of the best. That one right there, that's a Jake 1 beat. That's a Jake 1.
Jake 1? Let's see.
That's gotta be it.
I think that's a J. Cole.
That's a J. Cole really? All the way. All J. Cole on this one.
It did sound like a J. Cole written, beat, but Jake One in those fucking Jake One in those samples. Well, J. Cole in the samples too, but Jake One, that sounded like a Jake One beat.
Jake Cole's the only one credited for that song.
Okay.
All fronts.
Okay, Colstradamus.
Colstradamus. Okay. We got your next album title right there, J. Cole. Hell yeah.
Yup, just straight up J. Cole. Okay, I was wrong on that one. I did hear the snares, but it sounded like Jake 1 to me.
That one was deep, though, man. Talking about, you know.
And he did that thing you like. He did that thing you like again. That whole song, he kept that close. Everything rhymed with close. He did the same thing again. You didn't notice.
I was more or less listening, especially when he started talking about.
Because he was telling a story.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. He's talking about his boy. Now he chose to ride around with a nice car. Now you got to keep that gun on him because everyone looking at him. And I really like when he said that he decided to do lean as a joke, but now he's fucking addicted, and that one resonated with me because I know enough people.
And it started as a joke.
Yeah,
they want to do drugs. We in Texas, man. Lean is everywhere, just soaking minds up.
And I don't even just
both of y'all in Texas.
Yeah. Texas represent. You know what I'm saying? But it's just like any drug, like or just. He didn't really mention peer pressure. You just said it as a joke, but you know, people want to do shit to fit in, and mm-hmm. the next thing you know, a couple months later, that's just what the fuck they do. And yeah. a lot of times, it starts ruining their life.
That's how a lot of addictions start. You just fucking around or peer pressure. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm. Let me check these lyrics real quick. Mm-hmm. No, you're right. Yeah, the whole song. He starts with approach and ends on joke, and the rest of it is the O.
What was the other song that he did it on? Was it a
the song Applying Pressure? Before, I want to say it was Applying Pressure, I think.
It's that Danity Kane shit.
The Danity Kane, yeah.
Oh, it's Punching the Clock.
Punching the Clock, right. He had the ain all the way through, and this one he had the O. And that's... Man, if any of y'all have ever tried to be able to
tell a whole story,
right,
with the same rhyme all the way through,
mm-hmm. that's
this will separate the hymns from the me's, bro. Like when I rap, I just go rap. When he rap, it's literally like how Kobe go in the gym and just shoot and try to put himself in scenarios where like I'm trapped in the corner. What's my way out? Like he do that with writing. Like you know what I'm saying? Like it's a different. It's a different approach to rapping all together. Mm-hmm. And it's just, man, all I can do is learn from him, bro.
That's all anyone could do, man. That's is amazing.
Yeah.
All right. We got Hunger on Hillside with Boss number 12, last track on the album. And check it out and give y'all an outro and see what this one's got.
Bro, he's already...
telling us men, you better have dick discipline out here. Run fucking them hoes until you realize you the hoe.
That was definitely a bar. That shit caught me. I was like, damn.
I stopped fucking on them bitches like 6 years ago. You keep on fucking on until you realize that you the hoe.
And nobody thinks about it that way because, you know, the way society is and, you know, masculine roles and feminine roles and shit.
They even gonna hear that and be like, oh, you a bitch.
Right.
Nigga. Look at this bitch ass nigga talking about, he the hoe. I'll be damned if I'm the hoe. Them hoes the hoe.
You stupid. Everything y'all said was right. That track was, that might be one of my favorites too. I really like at the beginning. Like it had like the horns. I like when producers do that. Matter of fact, who produced this one?
This sound has only been used one other time that I can remember. And this is from the Sideline Story on, I can't remember the name of the song, but I think it was God's Gift? I can't remember. Or it might be Rise and Shine. Yeah, Rise and Shine. So this is definitely a J. Cole beat. Because that little, this ain't a J. Cole beat?
J. Cole's not on the producer list at all.
No shot.
It's three.
Are you bugging?
No shot.
I want to know that. I want to find that sample, though.
No, and see, that's what I was going to say. Because, like, you know, at the beginning, and I'm about to, like, play it real quick, and it's going to come to y'all.
That does not sound like Bay Boy Wonder.
But, like, I just really like when producers will take... like the whole or like at least a part of where they sample, especially if they just sample one section and loop it and let it loop up to that part, then loop from there. It's so simple, but I don't know. To me, it's always been
effective. That does not sound like a Boy Wonder beat. He did his homework. He definitely did his homework.
Shout out Boy Wonder.
Sample it.
Mm-hmm. You might be able to find it.
I've heard that shit before.
Yeah, that little tambourine sound and shit. Go listen to Rise and Shine. That's the only time I've ever heard J. Cole use that. So he did his homework. And it is dope. You want to know why? Because that's his very first album. So it's almost like coming full circle. So that I wish I could ask Boy Wonder where he got the inspiration for that. And if he just lied to me and say that, I'll be ecstatic. Because, I mean, that would be so fire. But right. that song was perfect. It was placed perfect. Like I said, it sounded like the sun is setting on that joint.
No, yeah. Like, and I feel like a lot of people will overlook that.
For sure. We know the shit like that.
Well, just like production in general and like how heavy of a role that plays in, you know, your general like emotions and how the album flows and everything. And the production on this whole shit was
Little was Junior Parker. I wonder where our love has gone.
Yeah.
That's the sample?
That's the sample.
I put it in our DMs.
I use Rise and Shine. Yeah, check out Rise and Shine. You'll hear that same like percussion. You'll hear that same fucking like little tambourine in there, whatever the fuck that is. That's why I thought it was J. Cole, but that shit was fire.
That was. I mean, again, the channel's called Fire or Ash, and you know, we're talking about the Fire or Ass, aka Ash. And man, this album is fire as fuck. I don't even think I really need to ask you guys. I'm sure from our talks we all feel that way. But I do again wanna the production is spot on. Obviously J. Cole did his thing, but you can't sleep on the impact of the production. Also, my man Boss, who can rap, was just like kind of, you know, singing and doing like backup vocals and chorus on the whole on the whole shit. I actually thought he was gonna be rapping to some of these, because I saw his name pop up. You know, shout out to him too. Shit was, this album is, man, it's a damn good fucking album.
It really is, bro. It really is.
Like, he showed his ass.
Yeah.
He showed his ass.
He went in on this, bro. Like, I played it back so many times. Like, I just let it ride. You know, I just play it and let it ride.
And it's crazy because you feel like this album makes you feel like he felt disrespected or something, but I don't remember anybody ever disrespecting his last album. So he, like, what that. The hell, like, made him, like, it just, something in him said, I'm not done. And I think he was talking about it on that 100 million shit. Like, he got 100 million, he's still grinding.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because he actually mentioned that in one of his songs. He was just like, he said, I have to make up my own like disrespect. Like, I had to manufacture my, I can't remember what song it was, but he was like, ain't nobody talking shit. I just have to make myself, like, something he said.
He said it on this album?
Nah, he said it on like Revenge of the Dreamers.
Okay.
Like Revenge of the Dreamers. He was just saying like, ain't nobody even talking shit about me. I have to manufacture my own type of animosity and shit. Cause it's like he just a very well respected dude, you know, and nobody don't really like bother him or nothing like that. But to us, we look at it like that, and like, okay, we can understand why he would feel that way. But like at the end of the day, it's like he's not being mentioned when we talk about certain things. And I would say it's because he's just not putting out as much as somebody like Drake or, you know, his peers. But you know, we can sit around and say why we feel like he's not mentioned, but to him just not being mentioned is enough motivation for him. Like, for this album, like in the documentary, he actually went back to the apartment that he was living in New York when he first like started grinding to make it. And he's like, that's where he recorded a lot of these songs. He was like, he had to get himself back in that element because, and you know, I can relate to it so much because I took such a long break. So just to hear him have those same struggles, my idol have those same struggles, it doesn't justify like me being gone, but it just shows that the struggles is real with motivation and stuff like that to flow. Cause I mean, it just has to be genuine. It like, if people say, just put something out. But if it's not genuine, then I really can't do it. You know what I'm saying?
People are going to feel that.
I need that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, shit. I loved it. Y'all loved it, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if y'all got anything else to say about it.
Anything I got nothing else.
Man, that was a great listen. Fire.
It didn't disappoint. It did not disappoint.
I'll be listening to this some more on my own.
For sure.
Like, I listened to this, and then I tried to listen in the Nicki joint, and I was like,
Nicki's album. That's the thing, and y'all, both of you know me. Y'all, you know, YouTube that may watch this may not know me as far as when it comes to music. Yeah, but I'm extremely critical when it comes to like the hip hop I listen to. And honestly, I don't think there was a single bad track on the album, and I wouldn't have been afraid to say it. They may not all have been like, oh my god, this song is great for different aspects, but I think everyone was good in its own right. And it's a solid project, one of the best full projects I've heard in a while, for sure.
Step your game up, peoples.
Mm-hmm.
Step your game.
Hell yeah. All right, we're going to get out of here, man. This whole thing was a certified fire from us. It was great, man. Thanks for
certified
watching.
Fire.
Hell yeah. I'm Majin Taj.
I'm Main.
Smooth.
Awesome.
If you want to plug, do it now.
I ain't got nothing to plug yet.
You know what I'm saying? We already plugged the joint, but it's like I said, it's Main Forever. I'm Main Forever on YouTube, Main Forever on twitch.tv. So, that's where we at, baby.
There you go. Y'all should know where you can find me. If you don't, you know, Majin Taj, wherever, Twitch, Twitter, all that good stuff. And watch some other videos on the channel, if you would, please. And yeah, we'll catch y'all on the next React Music. Movies, anime, whatever it is. See y'all later.
Sir.
Be easy.
Peace.